Another sidebar now as the questioning gets intense of Detective Jamie Lambert. Coming in now from Atlanta, joining us is prominent defense lawyer Randy Kessler. Randy, police are allowed to lie to witnesses, aren't they?
Well, they're allowed to. The bottom line is you're judging the credibility of the defendant, the witness. That's the bottom line. It's not really did the police lie, because the police are not on trial. The investigators are not on trial. The question is, did this person commit this crime or not? That's all you want the jury to know. So it's a nice distraction by the defense. They need to attack somebody. They're attacking her. But I think the jury is going to be thinking, why are you making this person into a victim? This person was just doing her job. That's my take.
Another sidebar with objections. We have our two guests here, Randy Kessler in Atlanta and Alan Tuckheimer in Chicago. Mr. Kessler, what do you think so far? They're throwing some shade here on the little girl's father, Jason Weshey.
They are. And, you know, it's funny when you heard the judge, you know, there was an objection. The judge could have ruled on it right there. When the judge says approach, the signal to me is he might say move along or where are you headed with this? He might be trying to give them a little more direction. But, you know, I think the defense has to keep on this as long as they can, because it's taking the attention off of their client. It's making somebody else the bad person. They've got to do as much of that as they can.
So they created an alternative theory of the case?
Either that or just sloppy enough work that the jury can't be convinced beyond a reasonable doubt. You don't always have to have another person did it, like the old defense of SOD, some other dude did it. As long as they can make sure that the jury isn't convinced 100% or beyond a reasonable doubt, then they've done their job. That's what they're aiming for.
Randy Kessler, while we wait for her to begin her testimony, we talked about this can backfire if you go too hard against officers of the law.
Right. I mean, the person on the witness stand is not accused of a crime. They're not defending themselves. And the more you make them defend themselves, the more you attack them. There are a lot of people on the jury that appreciate all the hard work. It's an underpaid, overworked job. A lot of people know investigators, police officers. That might create a little bit of sympathy for her. So, you know, this anger that's in the defense attorney's voice may backfire. You're absolutely right.
So Detective Lambert is being cross-examined by Lindsay Partin's lawyer, and she's been looking at some medical documents. Lawyer has asked for permission to publish that. Randy Kessler, I assume that means you let the jury see it?
And I like the witness's last answer when they said, you said that's what a typical bachelor pad looks like? And the answer was yes. And the counsel of war said, it is? And she didn't get baited into an argument. She could have said yes. She could have responded. But at least she didn't say, yeah, that's my opinion. You got something, you know, you want to say something about it? You want to argue? She just sat back and said, there's no reason to answer that. I said my piece.
Okay. Good for her. And here is the photo they've published for the jury. Killed babysitter. Well, killer babysitter. And Randy Kessler in Atlanta, very sad to see the little toys on the floor there in the apartment.
It is. It was a good way for the defense attorney to conclude. The defense lawyer is actually testifying, right? You can't tell whose house it is. You can't tell that's Lindsay Partin's house. Are those children's clothes? You're sure they're not children's clothes? The answer doesn't really matter. The jury hears what the defense lawyer wants them to hear. So tactically, strong by the defense. So
trial attorney Randy Kessler joins me to talk about this case. Randy, first of all, thank you for joining me here on the Daily Debrief. So we're hearing now from the defendant, maybe in the only way we will, through these police interrogations. We heard the 911 call. And now we're hearing about some of these other falls that the defendant suggests may have caused the injuries suffered by Hannah. What do you make of all this?
Well, it's sort of a unique way for the defense to look credible or to get some sympathy, because you got to make that tough decision, right? In every case, does the defendant take the stand? And putting that person up there, she's a victim, she looks like. She's, oh my God, you're going to accuse me of killing this child? I mean, I think her reaction was pretty authentic, although I don't know how I'd react if I really did kill somebody, because I couldn't even conceive of that. So, but it's getting some sympathy. You want to hear the defendant talk if you're on the jury, if you're the judge. Everybody wants to know, what's her position? What does she think about it? In this case, they got to see, and it wasn't that bad for her.
You know, I would agree with her demeanor. She seems appropriate, but then when she's talking about these falls 8 inches off the little train, and I don't know that the jury can envision the level of injury suffered by little Hannah from these kinds of falls. I'll tell you who I want to see next, though, okay, whether we see Partin or not take the stand. Where's Dad? I want to see Jason up on the stand. Jason Weshey, remember, he dropped the child off that morning, and within a very short period of time, she lost consciousness. So how important is it for the jury to hear from this guy and hear him fill in some of these holes?
Well, it sort of depends. If you're the defendant and you're afraid that he might present well, you'd rather have him be somebody they don't even meet and don't even know who he is, because sometimes imagination is worse than reality. Somebody did this horrible thing. And if they like the defendant or they think she's a likable person, reminds them of their sister, their mother, their whoever, it might be easier to pin it on somebody who's sort of anonymous. So maybe the defense doesn't want that person there. Maybe the prosecution does, to say, look, this guy's a nice guy. It couldn't have been him. So depending on which side you're on, you may or may not want him. But I think the jury, of course, would be curious, because if in their mind he's a possible suspect, they certainly want to see him and hear from him.
Yeah, I think what they're going to have to go through is, if he does not testify, is they're going to have to be comfortable either finding this defendant guilty or figuring it was some other cause. And if he doesn't take the stand, they're left to kind of their own imagination as to what that other cause might be. I just think these falls that we've heard about are just so minor. What I also wanted to ask you about was the timeline within which these things happened and the injuries appeared. I mean, isn't it possible that some older injuries ultimately, you know, took effect and ultimately killed this girl?
Yeah, all that's possible. I mean, do you believe science or do you believe what your eyes and ears are telling you? And that's the best thing about the interview for the defendant. She looked credible. And if the jury can't get that out of their mind, that, God, what if I was falsely accused? I would react the exact same way. I would say, no, I promise that's what happened. If they can't get that out of their mind, even if they're convinced by the science and by the doctors and by the investigators, if it's a balancing act and they're not convinced beyond a reasonable doubt, they still are doubting it, there may not be a conviction.
Is this a case in which it just sometimes becomes too easy to blame this defendant because the case is so heartbreaking and you have such a young victim?
Yeah, I mean, I think
it almost it makes the defense position so much weaker, it seems.
Yeah, because there's not any other alternative explanations. There's a good scientific explanation for it, and then there's this crazy story, which is what anybody would use as a story if they actually killed somebody. You would say, oh, my God, I'm going to have to say she fell. I'm going to have to do something like that. So it's a balance. But again, you know, that's why we have jury trials. That's why there's not a plea. They think there's a chance she's going to get off. Or there's not a good enough offer. But you're right, the prosecution has to pretty much say it's A plus B equals C. Ladies and gentlemen, don't leave your common sense at home. Children do not just fall like this. These things do not happen. You've heard the scientists, the doctors, the technology. We've told you and we've proven the only way this happened was by human interaction. The babysitter did it, put her in jail.
Attorney Randy Kessler joined me once again. Now, Randy, it sure sounds like he understands the charges against him and is able to help his attorneys in his defense. That's basically what he needs to do to be competent. But we know that could change at any time. So as we move forward, at what point is it safe? I mean, what if the jury gets the case, but before delivering a verdict, he loses it and is no longer competent? What happens then?
Well, you know, once the evidence is already in and then the evidence is closed, the jury has to make a decision based on what the evidence is before them. So, you know, the bottom line is, I don't know that this is going to work. I think a lot of jurors see insanity as a get-out-of-jail-free card. You're not really paying the penalty. But, yeah, you know, what if he stops the trial? What if he has a seizure in the middle of trial? There are lots of things that could go about causing the trial to end prematurely, a mistrial. But so far, they've got the doctors on board, so they're going with the doctors who say he's competent.
And it's just really a ticking clock as to whether his meds hold out and then he stays with it. You mentioned something very important, you know, the jury. What do they really think not guilty by reason of insanity means?
I think the layperson, and I've talked to a lot of folks about this, and we teach trial law at Emory, they think that's a get out of jail free. They think it's not legitimate that, you know, of course he's somewhat crazy. What kind of person would do something like that? But he's not crazy enough that he shouldn't have to pay the same consequences that anybody else would. He lives in our country. He's subject to the same rules. He violated the rules. He pays the consequences. Saying insanity. People don't understand insanity. And not to lighten it, but mental health is really a problem in America, and a lot of people don't understand mental health, and it's going to work against him. There are a lot of mentally ill people. There are people that have a lot of mental health problems. The problem is you don't see mental health, right? You don't see it like a broken arm. So a lot of jurors are going to discount it and not believe it.
Very quickly now, we just got a few seconds left here, Randy. The defense is about done with their case. We'll hear a brief rebuttal. What should the prosecution focus on?
I don't know what the prosecution should focus on. I think if I was a prosecutor, I'd say the facts are the facts are the facts. I'd keep it very simple. I'd say he was caught in the act. You have an honest cop just doing his job, an innocent child, and a guy who should do everything in the world to prevent exactly what he did to his daughter.